Hello everyone, I'm Mirvat Alasnag. I'm an ESC program committee member and an interventional cardiologist in Saudi Arabia. With me here is Dr. Fahd Al-Shaibi, interventional cardiologist and head of the cardiac center in the military hospital in Saudi Arabia. And this is day one of the ESC Congress, and a lot of new information was presented today, including the guidelines, which I want to dive right into. Dr. Al-Shaibi, the acute coronary syndrome guidelines were presented earlier today. So you want to tell us a quick summary on what were the most relevant recommendations that came out of those guidelines today?
Well, yeah, as you said, the ACS guidelines for 2023 were announced this morning, and they are essentially a update on a combination of the 2017 STEMI guidelines and the 2020 non-STEMI guidelines. They've been put into one guideline for ACS. Obviously, ACS is a spectrum that covers both STEMI and non-STEMI. As far as the pathways for STEMI pathway and the non-STEMI pathway, there are really no significant changes for the STEMI pathway. But in the non-STEMI pathway, there was some significant changes in the recommendation. The prior recommendation for high-risk non-STEMIs, and that is revascularization within the first 24 hours that previously in the 2017, in the 2020 guidelines had received a 1A recommendation, has been downgraded to a 2A recommendation. The reasons for that were really pinned on a large meta-analysis done of prior studies that was published in 2022 that showed that the early strategy of cathing these patients within the first 24 hours didn't really affect the hard endpoints of mortality, and most of the benefit was for recurrent ischemic events. Furthermore, these earlier studies on which that underpinned this recommendation did not include the screening of these patients for high sensitivity troponins. Another interesting change in the guidelines was related to the timing or the type of pretreatment we give these patients who present with ACS. Aspirin remains a class 1 indication for these patients, but as far as P2Y12 inhibitors, there's been a change. They're no longer recommended as a class 1 recommendation as pretreatment, but rather receive a 2B. Recommendation for a STEMI patient, and actually a class 3 indication for a non-STEMI patient. Another change, I think, in the guidelines that was interesting was relating to dual antiplatelet therapy in the high bleeding risk patients. And here again, dual antiplatelet recommendation received a 2B indication for all patients and a class 2A recommendation of an abbreviated 3 to 6 month regimen for these type of patients. There were also interesting recommendations regarding imaging and the completeness of revascularization that maybe you'd like to expand on.
Yeah, so what was very interesting here is that for intracoronary imaging in patients who have an acute coronary syndrome and an identifiable culprit, the use of intracoronary imaging, be it intravascular ultrasound or optical coherence tomography, to guide PCI was afforded a class 2A recommendation. And for those without an identifiable culprit, the recommendation was a 2B to use intracoronary imaging with a preference to use OCT. So that was in terms of intracoronary imaging. But then in terms of complete revascularization, one new recommendation actually came, and it was for those who present with an acute STEMI and cardiogenic shock, a 2A recommendation for staging the non-infarct related vessel for these patients who have shock. While the prior 2A recommendation in terms of doing the revascularization during the index piece admission or procedure and up to 45 days in a standard STEMI was class 1 recommendation. But what was very interesting in this guidelines or this section of the guidelines was that angiography was really the basis for evaluating these patients who have multivessel disease and are presenting with acute coronary syndrome.
In the acute setting.
In the acute setting. And so this was a class 1B recommendation there to use angio guidance only. But I really want to move on to another set of guidelines that were actually very interesting and were presented today as well, was the endocarditis guidelines. Now, it included 34 new recommendations, but really a few of them are ones that we ought to highlight for our viewers. The first is it was patient-centered, so they did focus on educating the patients, making sure they're aware of oral hygiene, dental hygiene, tattoos, and so on. But we've all noticed as clinicians an uptick of endocarditis in the past few years, and I'm glad that the new guidelines did address them in terms of prophylaxis. But another interesting aspect that came out of the endocarditis guidelines is they did add the use of imaging aside from echo, such as PET and CT, for the evaluation of these patients, and it was afforded a class 2A recommendation. Now, I know you and I had discussions earlier today about the endocarditis guidelines, and there was other issues, other recommendations that are perhaps practice changing. So what are your thoughts on those?
Yeah, well, as you know, this guideline is I think the last endocarditis guidelines were, if I'm not mistaken, 2015 or 2017. So it's been quite a while since these guidelines were updated. And there's an important segment here, I think, on outpatient antibiotic therapy here, which actually received a 2A recommendation now for patients with uncomplicated infective endocarditis. However, obviously, higher risk patients, those with resistant organisms, those that have complicated endocarditis with abscess formation or post-surgical complicated cases, continue to require in-hospital intravenous antibiotics as prior recommendations. Another one was relating to surgical intervention in these patients, and there were new class one recommendations made in these type of patients. And one of these was a 1A recommendation related to valve replacement when treating patients with early prosthetic valve endocarditis, early being within the first 6 months. So it's a class one indication to replace those valves and perform a thorough surgical debridement. The other one, the other new class one recommendation for surgical intervention was for those patients who suffer an embolic stroke, an ischemic stroke, and in those in whom the overall neurological prognosis is good for meaningful recovery, they should not be denied surgery, and it's a class one indication to operate on these patients.
So the other guidelines that also came out were the diabetes guidelines, a lot about the new agents that are now available to us in patients, even with and without cardiovascular events. So could you just give us a very brief update on those, Dr. Shaibi?
Well, yeah, I think, again, as you mentioned, the GLP-1 agonists continue to gain strength and momentum in the cardiovascular arena. And I think the most relevant notes I made in this guideline section were related to the GLP-1 agonists and the GLT-2 inhibitors. And that generally they receive now class 1 indications for patients with diabetics with all forms of cardiovascular manifestations, whether we are talking about treating a STEMI patient who's a diabetic, a non-STEMI patient, an unstable angina patient, a chronic coronary syndrome patient, heart failure with preserved EF, with moderate LV dysfunction, with severe LV dysfunction. For all these categories of patients, the presence of diabetes and cardiac disease gives these agents, both the GLP-1 and the GLT-2 inhibitors, a class 1 indication.
And that's irrespective of ejection fraction or diabetes.
Absolutely.
Control, hemoglobin A1C. So.
Absolutely. It's a very broad class 1 indication for the use of these agents in all diabetics with cardiovascular disease of any sort. Now, the other second point was screening of diabetics who do not have overt atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease and do not have evidence of end organ damage. And again, this was a new class 1 recommendation to screen these patients using a new scoring system, the score 2 diabetes system, which would divide these patients into low, moderate, high, and very high risk groups. And obviously, each category receives further recommendations regarding treatment strategies.
Correct. And, you know, just the next guidelines that did come out were related to heart failure, but brand new were the cardiomyopathy guidelines.
Yes.
That actually came out. And there was a lot of emphasis on phenotypic assessment of these patients, genetic assessment of these patients, even when considering, ICD implantation. So going beyond an absolute ejection fraction or a number and really doing a lot more testing, Interesting again here is that MRI was upgraded in terms as a recommendation here for these patients. And so patient involvement, a lot of algorithms, it was a very solid guidelines. And, you know, to wrap up day one, I think we cannot just stop at the guidelines. It is important that we also talk about some of the trials that were presented here. So, Dr. Al-Shaibi, what is one trial presented today in the hotlines that you want to cover?
Well, again, I'm going to go back to the GLP-1 agonists. They just are gaining traction. And the STEP heart failure preserved ejection fraction study was very interesting. It tested the hypothesis that patients with obesity, not necessarily diabetes, but obese patients with heart failure and preserved ejection fraction might benefit from weight reduction that can be achieved with GLP-1 agonists. So the STEP heart failure preserved ejection fraction trial was a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study that involved 96 sites in 13 countries and included patients with preserved EF and obesity. Preserved EF was an ejection fraction of more than 45%, and obesity was defined as a BMI of greater than 30. With heart failure symptoms. The endpoints for the trial, there were two endpoints. One was the improvement in symptoms as gauged by the Kansas City cardiomyopathy questionnaire, and the change in body weight. And in fact, this trial, which used semaglutide compared to placebo, and the mean dose of semaglutide was 2.4 milligrams given once a week for the duration of the trial, which was 1 year, 52 weeks, was positive for both endpoints. There was a significant improvement in quality of life as measured by the Kansas City score. There was a significant reduction in body weight in the semaglutide group compared to the placebo group. And these results were confirmed in the six-minute walk test, which was significantly again improved in the group treated actively with the GLP-1 agonist. So I think this was a very important study that's probably going to be reflected in the next set of guidelines, which is going to add another indication for GLP-1 agonists in patients with heart failure and obesity, not necessarily diabetics.
And just one last trial that I think we should cover in today's wrap-up is really the COP-AF trial. There's been a lot of momentum with colchicine, as you know, in both setting of the acute coronary syndromes and chronic coronary syndromes, so on. In this trial, the COP-AF trial, they really looked at the role of colchicine administered 0.5 milligrams at least 4 hours or within 4 hours of the operation. And the endpoint was looking at a reduction in clinically relevant atrial fibrillation and myocardial injury that is non-fatal in these patients who are undergoing thoracic surgery, but it's non-cardiac surgery. You know, they enrolled over 2,000 patients, placebo and group, and the colchicine group were quite similar. Actually, it was 3,000 patients. It was one-to-one randomization. Close to 48% were women. The mean age was 68 years, but unfortunately did not meet the primary endpoint or the secondary endpoint, so there was really no difference in the rates of both myocardial injury or clinically relevant atrial fibrillation when using a colchicine. So that was a wrap-up of today's sessions at Amsterdam, and we'll be with you again tomorrow with another wrap-up of the ESC Congress.